Thank you for that very kind introduction. And since I have 20 minutes, I usually like to open up with a sense of humor. No time for that, so I'm going to go right to the slide presentation. And hopefully I'll add some humor once we get there. It's rotating. So it's certainly a pleasure to be here, and it's always interesting to see your life fly before your eyes. But this is something I enjoy talking about, and so I'm very thrilled to be here. So my talk is really going to focus on really the urban landscape and public health, but I always like to put my conversation in context to understand exactly how this nation is urbanizing and why we need to do the work that we do. And if you go back to the 19th century, our population of the U.S. was nearly 5 million with an urbanized population of 6%. By the 20th century, primarily due to immigration, our population swelled to 76 million, 40% urbanized. You can see where we're in the 21st century, and then we're heading to the 22nd century. And we look at the 22nd century to see how we're going to become more urbanized, and people say, that's far off. No, it's not. A person born today will live to see the 22nd century. So we're resetting our time horizon to understand exactly what we need to do to prepare for this urbanization, not just here in the U.S., but all over the world. So over the next 50 years, we here in the U.S. have to figure out where we're going to accommodate 124 million people, approximately 60 million new housing units, and right here in New York, over 780,000 people, and we have to find a place for 313,000 new housing units. And it's not just those housing units, but as we grow, density and open space go together. If you want to have a livable city, we have to also figure out where those open spaces and natural areas will be preserved, and that will be our challenge. And in doing this, can we plan for a healthier community, or will density overwhelm us? Open space and parks will be critical to that equation. And when we look at our urban systems, often we don't think of our parks and open space as a system. It is vital to how we function. It is part of our infrastructure for health, for mental well-being, and is connected to a lot of other systems, but we have to look very differently. It's not just a green space amenity that is over there. It's vital to public health, to our environment, and it's something we have to rethink going forward that is an essential part of how we design and build our cities. And as was mentioned, we have an enormous park system. Most people don't realize close to 30,000 acres, 10,000 of which are natural areas. Close to 2,000 parks, millions of trees. All this comes under the jurisdiction of the Parks Department, not just for our environment, but to keep our community and our citizens healthy as they live here in this city. But I want to take a step back, because I wrote an article, which you'll see in a second, that the beginning of the planning movement, actually public health professionals and planners were joined by the hip. We were whether cousins or brothers and sisters. And because of the fact that urbanizing our cities were killing people for lack of proper sanitation, housing conditions, and all other factors, we had these forces come together in 1909 at the first city planning conference, and we had these two opposing figures. One was Benjamin March, who really upheld social values and was very concerned about people, and the other was Frederick Law Olmsted Jr., the son of Frederick Olmsted, that was more concerned about the physical nature, about cities being more efficient, liberal, attractive, and less chaotic. There was basically a battle between these two about what the city planning profession would look like. Sadly, Frederick Law Olmsted won. It was people versus place, and place won by 1911, and the two professions went their separate directions. Planners focused on the physical, spatial, and regulatory issues. Public health professionals and other social reformers tried to find a way of making people live healthier lives and prevent chronic diseases. And those social issues were kind of delegated to social workers and progressive planners. Planners didn't want that sticky stuff, social stuff, affecting their work. They wanted to be free. But because of the impact to our environment over all those years, I'm grateful to say we started to unite again back in the 1990s. Why? This is just one map. Like in the turn of the century or the 20th century, the way we planned, we're killing people or hurting them. That was not done purposely. But the way we're building our communities through urban sprawl and auto-centric society, and you can see now how West Virginia, Arkansas, and Mississippi are now dropping, leaping off the map in terms of their level of obesity. They're even adding another category by CDC because the obesity levels are getting so severe. So what does that mean for us in the 21st century? Many of the issues you see on this list are happening for the first time. They're brand new. So you can't Google to find a solution to these problems. And during your career, you're going to be addressing these issues. Now, the reason I added one, this is a list I rarely change. I only added two in the last 10 years. But obesity, public health, and food security is one of the dominant emerging issues in the 21st century will define your career. So it's something that I'm all pleased that you're here because you're in the right profession, at the right time, and at the right place. And so because of my passion about how I believe that planning professionals and public health professionals are so aligned, I wrote this commentary for the New York North Carolina Journal of Medicine to show that planners and public health professionals need the partner again because of the emerging issue in the 21st century. Place is a major contributor of how we plan for our public health. And it's something I encourage you to read because we need, as Diana said, those alliances in order to solve these problems. You cannot do it within your public health bubble. You need to reach out and work with others to achieve it. Around that same time, when I was president of the American Planning Association, planners realized that we had to send that message out to all the planning departments and came up with a sustaining places guide and based all new plans on 8 principles. We told the planners throughout the country, if you're going to develop a comprehensive plan, you need to have these 8 principles, and clearly healthy communities had to be part of it. So I took that to heart. And when we did our comprehensive plan, we made sure that it wasn't just a separate element or chapter in our comprehensive plan, but public health had to transcend all the chapters, from land use to transportation to parks, open space, and the environment. And as a result, this was adopted in 2009. After a survey, APA found that we were the top city comprehensive plan in the country that adopted at least 50% of our health topics was in that plan. And it was great outcomes. The public supported us, and now, although I left Raleigh, they're implementing or have implemented many of those recommendations. The plan, as I stated, focused on healthy policies, expanded parks, connected open space. Our greenway was not just for recreation, but also for transportation. So someone could get on a bike and ride from their community all the way down to their place of employment. We actually approved the bond for sidewalk. Now, if you go to North Carolina, there aren't sidewalks everywhere. And so in order to make sure we had them, rather than asking a homeowner to build a sidewalk, we passed a bond to build them ourselves. We also were first that we actually created a category in our zoning code for urban agriculture. Urban farms and community gardens were not just vacant land that you can garden, but it actually had a protected status in the zoning code because we knew the importance of providing healthy foods in some of our food deserts, and now this whole industry is exploding. And also we focused on our seniors, an aging population. We didn't just want to put them on the edge of town in senior centers, we want to integrate them in various places throughout our community. You're seeing what's called a cottage court, which is a new zoning category where seniors can live independently and walk to their services versus being isolated at the outskirts of town. We also came up with what was called, we had a blueprint for growth, but we also want to have a greenprint for growth. And this represents 8,800 acres in the city of Raleigh, 11% of the city's footprint. Here in New York, parkland represents 14% of the footprint. And then at this point, there are over 80 miles of greenway. And a lot of people like to come to this city because it offers that healthy lifestyle. And so now we have our greenprint to guide how we grow to be a healthy community into the future. So that's North Carolina. I'm not there now. I'm back in the greatest city in the world, New York City. And so what is New York City in public health? How are we beginning to advance that initiative here? I'm going to touch on 3, equity, planning and placemaking, and then 1 NYC. The first, let's talk about equity. When I say equity, I mean fairness. Are we fair at how we distribute our resources? Are we fair about how we maintain our parks? About a year ago, the mayor announced this new framework for an equitable future, and one of the key features of this effort was a community parks initiative. What is that initiative? Essentially, when we put things in context, over the past couple of decades, New York invested over close to $6 billion in investment, added about a little over 1,100 acres, and about 3/4 of the population within a 10-minute walk to a park. That's a good metric. But for us, it wasn't just about proximity, it was about quality. Because I can go to some of those parks and I would not let my child play in that playground. And so we knew while proximity was important, we had to also look at quality so that would be a useful place for people to get healthy, play, and enjoy their lives. So we did this analysis to find out how many of our parks over the last 2 decades, received $250,000, over 2 decades. And it turned out there were 215. 215 parks hiding in plain sight. Families and children and seniors did not have a quality space to enjoy and live healthy lifestyles, and you'll see an example in a second. And so our goal with this initiative, that we're now investing over $285 million to recreate a total redesign of 67 community parks so that now these families can enjoy a quality park. And because that'll take 3 years to implement, we decided to go in right now and make investments in those parks and improvements, short-term, targeted, but at least the community knows that we care. We're improving it with whether it's sports coating or putting more plants in horticulture and lawn restoration. There was 85, and all those have been, most have been completed last year. And the transformation has been enormous. So here's an exciting playground. Wouldn't you want to go to your neighborhood park and enjoy yourselves here with a nice picnic, blanket, glass of wine? So my question is this really a park or a parking lot? In fact, I was here with a council member. We were all looking around to find one blade of grass, and we found one right over there in the corner. This was included in that walk score. This was the type of open space that we expected our residents to be healthy. I have a better one. What a great place to hang. Look at that. There's a bench there. At least there's a bench and a couple of trees. Could you imagine yourself just going out to the space, enjoying yourself? This is what we ask of our New Yorkers, to go out to this open space and enjoy. We knew we had to be better. And you can tell by how many people are in this space how popular it is in this neighborhood. So we decide to reset how we're going to do things in the future and come up with a design precedent that's going to be different for parks and have more energy efficient spray showers that offer enjoyment and cooling off in the wintertime and also having beauty and a more adult and children fitness where they can actually go to a park and replace that asphalt with ways of getting healthy. We're beginning to rethink, you know, how we design for playgrounds for young and other gathering places to make it more inviting and be a center of a community and not no longer an eyesore. And we're using bioswales and working with other departments to make these areas attractive so people can sit down and enjoy themselves, not just for recreation, but really just to feel alive and let their brains relax and enjoy themselves. And we understand we have an aging population, and parks are not just for young people, but we have to start planning for multiple generations. By observation, as you heard, I go to a lot of parks on weekends, that seniors tend to like to sit at the edge of a park or a safe zone. And so we have to make sure that we design the new generation of our parks to address all households, because a lot of seniors want to go out there and watch children play and just enjoy the outdoors, and we should be accommodating and not say they can't come in because they're not accompanied by a child. And so we have to rethink how we design for our parks. So as a result of the Community Parks Initiative, we will be able to impact over 65 acres of urban parkland and truly touch these 35 projects. Will now really give 220,000 New Yorkers a 10-minute walk to the park that they really did not have before. So we're excited this project, these will be expected to come online by the end of 2017. And we're very excited about how many neighbors, 55, will be touched by this initiative. We also don't want to forget our natural areas, our urban forest, and our ecosystem. As I stated, there are over 10,000 natural areas in our city, 2 million trees in our parks, 650 street trees, and 150 miles of coast. And by the way, if you didn't know this, we planted our 1 millionth tree last year in Joyce Kilmer Park, and we intend to plant even more in the future because of not only environmental benefits, but also the health benefits to our parks. And I want to emphasize that the benefits of parks is not just our physical health, but also to our mental health as well. There were so many studies this year coming out about the effect parks and trees have on your brain, on your mental and physical health, and this is something we want to expand and the work that we do. We want to take it outside the park. Here are examples of some of our green streets where we expand that natural beauty, that green beauty, out into our street network, and something that you'll see more of into the future. And then I want to shift gears, because this was something that was foreign to our Parks Department, but being a planner, what did you expect? I decided to explore planning and placemaking, and to really understand that our demographics are changing, we have to understand who we're planning for. We're getting older, living longer. We're seeing a rise in multi-generational households and single-person households, and so we had to plan accordingly. At any given time, there are six generations, and each one of those generations have different values, needs, and aspirations for what they want to see in a neighborhood and what they want to see in a park. We cannot just plan for who is in the room during the meeting. We have to understand who lives in that community from generations to cultural backgrounds, so that if we want them to get healthy, we have to really understand their needs and what they're looking for in public space. In New York City, well over 62.7% of New Yorkers are generations X, Y, or Z. That's 47 and below, but they're not often at the public meetings. And so we have to do a better job to reach out. So when we plan these parks, we're planning for present and also future generations. Why do I say that? If I had to generalize, previous generations were consumers of goods, but the younger generations are consumers of experiences. And as we plan for our public spaces, whether for mental health or for physical health, it's about the experience, and I'll show you some examples. This is so important because 40% of our city is within the public realm, parks, streets, and sidewalks. And we want to make sure that we enhance that experience of that public realm as we grow as a city. So here are parks and public spaces. I believe they're the living rooms of our city. This is Riverside South, one of our newer parks. And as I stated, parks are for mental as well as physical health. This also is Riverside South Park. People are going here because of the experience they're getting from our parks. Now here's an odd one. People are actually sitting, looking over a street. Why are they doing that? Because of the experience they're getting. This is on the High Line. This is a popular spot. They're hanging out, looking at a street. It's the experience that they're getting. Here they are once again. This used to be a traffic island. And now this is part of a street near 14th Street and 8th Avenue. They're sitting in the middle of the street. Why? It's because of the experience that they're getting. They're getting outdoors, enjoying themselves. And of course, the most three-dimensional experience you can get in New York, the High Line, this too, again, is getting people outdoors because of the experience that they're getting. And so that brings me to another major initiative that we've launched called Parks Without Borders. Basically, what we're trying to do is look at New York City and how we can increase some of the access. But first, I'll show you some of the examples. So this is Rufus King Park. Little dog, please let me sniff the grass. But for some reason, this person has to walk about another 7 minutes before they can get into that park. Why is there a fence there? Oh, here's another example. We have two fences protecting one tree, two trees. What are we protecting? here's a handball court. Looks like a wall. This is right next to swings. I guess they feel the child could bounce 20 feet and traverse the fence. Oh, this is one of my favorites. So there's a worry here that the trees are gonna run away at night. So we had to make sure we put a fence around it to make sure they don't run. But we did have a little opening. The community wants to convert this to a butterfly garden, and there's a little walking sidewalk around us. We're not sure why, but they were delighted to know the fence can actually come down. Also, parks, as Frederick Law Olmsted once said, sidewalks are the outer parks. And we no longer want to plan for the edge of the park where the wall is, but to the edge of the curb. This is right next to Fort Greene Park on Myrtle Avenue. That's the front door, the front porch of that park. That's very active, that people want to enjoy, and we have to rethink how to incorporate that entire space into the park itself. Here's another one, putting up a fence here for no reason. These residents have to walk about 7 minutes to get to the entrance. We're starting to remove these fences. And this is a double D pool. Looks like a nice area where summer camps can play and have lunch, but this is not what it really looks like. It really looks like that. Why are we doing this? If we want to be healthy, let's remove the barriers and increase access. This is an example in North Carolina and Greensboro, where they decided to remove the fence and have an integrated public realm, park, sidewalk, integrated. You know, the average citizen doesn't know when they're on parks property or DOT property, and guess what? They don't care. They want to have a seamless public realm that is unified, and as we grow with all this density, we have to start reclaiming space that we just took for granted. That's a sidewalk, so it's only for walking. No, not really. It has more purposes. So we launched this new initiative through One NYC called Parks Without Borders. We have $50 million to make this a reality. The goal is to make parks more welcoming and to increase that walk to a park to 85% by 2030, extend the beauty of our parks into communities, and transform underused spaces into centers of the community so people can get out and be physically and mentally more healthy. It focuses on three things: edges, entrances, and adjacent park spaces. And you can see from the slide, we don't need that retaining wall. There's a fence for an upswing, and then all that unused space at the bottom slide is actually something the park maintains but doesn't use. It's just underutilized space that can be reincorporated into the park. So our approach is to open up sight lines, remove gates, address some of the furnishings and amenities that draw people into the park. I'd rather have light and fewer barriers than dark with high barriers. It makes it more inviting, and here's a before and after photo. This one allows better views into the park. It increases natural surveillance so that as people look inside the park, they feel more safe, and bring more furniture out to the sidewalk, since that technically is the outer park, the front porch of the park, to encourage more people to get outdoors and be healthy. And then rethink these adjacent spaces that are near community centers, libraries, that are just fenced off. Let's open them up for more community interaction activity. This is something we believe can work. One example that right now will be completed by, October 2017, is Traverse Park. The photo on the left is what it looks like right now. High fence, asphalt, basic asphalt playground. And the plan, which got approved, is now gonna bring the whole park experience, seating, horticulture. It now expands the experience and better connects the community to their park. Now, that's not the only initiative in One NYC. There's a strong emphasis throughout the document on public health. And what I love about this is we're collaborating with other agencies. I'll give you a couple of examples. Mental health, we're helping them on their building healthy communities. Department of City Planning, with all the rezonings, we're making sure that open space amenities is clearly part of every plan. With DOT, I'd mentioned, we're doing a lot of work on the public realm. And then with DEP in terms of green infrastructure. So there is a strong emphasis throughout this plan on healthy living, and so this is why I truly enjoy working with my colleagues to help implement it. Also good news, community gardens. We also oversee over 600 community gardens. We got about another 30 last year, and this also gives an opportunity for people to live healthy, be connected to their community. Also, we're experimenting more with what we call creative play, so kids can get healthier without play equipment, just run up and down, roll down the hill, and have a great time. We're incorporating more creative play in our design. Also, if you could just put paint on a sidewalk and you put a dot and kids hop their way right into the playground. So this is an inexpensive way of getting kids healthy. Paint, dots, playground, done. They're healthy. And you have to program your space, and I cannot tell you how proud I am of our agency. Over 3 million visits to our rec centers. Hundreds of thousands of people, Kids in Motion, Shape Up NYC, we even go out to where you are to make sure that you get healthy. And this is a partnership with Department of Health and other sponsors. It is just making our city a much more vibrant place to live. And our goal is to build a healthier and happier city. And I thank you all, and I look forward to your questions.